A week since floods put much of Buller underwater, there is a severe weather warning in place once again for northern and upper western parts of the South Island. But the last 2 months has seen a series of extreme weather events causing death and destruction around the world. China is the latest country to be saturated by record rainfall. In Jingzhou on Wednesday, at least 25 people died, 12 of those in an underground train after the tunnel was flooded. Several dams were destroyed and hundreds of thousands of people evacuated in what scientists describe as a once-in-millennium weather event. Contrast that with Siberia, where a heatwave has led to unprecedented wildfires this week. The air pollution in nearby towns and cities is so bad, residents were told not to step outside. The heat's causing issues in Scandinavia as well. In the Norwegian county of Saltdal, right near the Arctic Circle, a new record temperature of 34 degrees was recorded this month. Last week, the UN confirmed Antarctica has also set a new record temperature. The frozen continent hit 18 degrees Celsius. The clean-up continues in Europe after ruinous floods killed approximately 200 people in Germany and Belgium. While in the United States and Canada, more than 1,000 people died last month in a record-breaking heatwave. Wildfires in the same region are causing haze and air pollution almost 5,000 kilometres away in New York. And of course, here in New Zealand. Mid-Canterbury was smashed last month, while cow carcasses had to be scraped up off beaches following last week's floods in Buller. So how much of the damage and destruction can we directly attribute to climate change? And should scientists in the media be doing more to link climate disasters with human-caused climate change? Sam Dean is NIWA's principal climate scientist and works in the field of attribution, where scientists determine if a weather event is directly influenced by climate change. Tēnā koe, welcome to the show, Sam. What is attribution science?
Kia ora, Jack. Attribution science is where we consider the contribution that climate change has made to something like an extreme weather event, so the West Coast flooding or the East Coast flooding in Canterbury, or say the big heat wave in Canada and the US is the best example. The study came out very recently saying that such an event was virtually impossible without climate change. So that's that heat wave, you know, the chances of it happening naturally without the warming that we've put into the planet, virtually impossible. We put some precise numbers on it, but you know, that's great.
What is the broad purpose of attribution science? Is it just to win over anyone who might be sceptical about the impacts of climate change?
That's true. I think we talk a lot about the distant future with climate change and projections, and that people can become disconnected from that. So talking, bringing it back to the now, making it real, making it in your back garden, and talking about how climate change has altered the world we live in already makes it more real for people, and that makes it, you know, you're having your policy discussions right now about whether to do this or to do that in response to mitigating or adapting to climate change. So that's the role it plays for sure.
So you and your colleagues have been considering two of the major weather events in New Zealand over the last couple of months, those floods in Canterbury on the east coast of the South Island, and then of course the floods last weekend on the west coast of the South Island in Buller. Are you at the stage where you can say whether or not those events were caused or influenced by climate change?
Yeah, we're working really hard on that right now. We're not ready yet to go with a definitive statement about how much they've been affected. They will both have been affected to some degree by climate change. What we can say is that the west coast flooding, the Buller and the Wairau flooding in Marlborough, because they happened in the winter on the west coast of the South Island, you know, rain into the mountains and the main divides, that sort of event is the ones that most likely to be influenced by climate change. We've both got more moisture in the air and we've got a greater frequency of those weather events happening because of climate change, because of the way it's affected the circulation and of the atmosphere in New Zealand.
And when you get to the point where you can say how much has been influenced by climate change, is it just the sort of thing where you say this is 20% worse than it would have been?
Yeah, so we'll often, I think I heard you on the radio the other day getting exactly right, talking about how for the West Coast it might be a doubling in the chances. So while that event could have happened naturally, the risk of that happening has doubled because of climate change. So it will be about that, about a doubling of the risk. So it's become twice as likely in any given year.
It's the frequency of events rather than just the strength of a particular event.
Yeah, it's both of them. When they happen, they are more intense, but they're also more likely for that west coast in the winter. And so they're facing some of the biggest changes for flooding in New Zealand on the west coast of the South Island. The other place that's really exposed is Northland. So they see those changes due to those tropical cyclones, which we don't expect to increase in frequency, but those tropical cyclones get more intense when they do come. So that's a real intensity effect that increased short duration heavy downpours in Northland, in the top half of the North Island. They're a significant concern as well.
I know that the groundswell farmers protest concerned a lot of different issues, but some of the issues that people were protesting were climate change policies. Did you see an irony in the groundswell protest being followed immediately by an event that is likely to have been influenced by climate change and smashed farmers?
Yeah, I think it's important that we make the connection between taking action and implementing change to what otherwise is going on around us. You know, we've had a lot of warming, we're having more extreme events. I think this what's going on around the world at the moment is quite scary, and it'll be interesting to see what studies come out of that in terms of the kind of crazy place we're going. I think farmers, you know, are really adaptable. They experience the weather really closely on the land, but they are going to have to either lead or face the consequences of regulations. And so I encourage them to lead. I encourage them to set the agenda for how they are going to reduce emissions. But it's more than just farming, right? It's like we need to stop burning coal. We need to stop burning oil. I think there's a big climate meeting happening in all the governments in late November, later this year in the UK. And I think the conversation will be about, you know, not using coal for power generation. And New Zealand is importing vast amounts of coal at the moment to generate electricity, and we have to stop doing that. We have to stop burning coal, and we have to stop polluting the atmosphere, or we will live with the consequences of that. And I do get scared sometimes, but I'm hopeful. I think, you know, we can come together and make a difference and have a better outcome than the one we're on at the moment.
Why do you get scared?
We're doing a crazy thing. The rate of change on the planet right now is way more rapid than anything in human history. Our existence, evolution, and has not prepared us for this time. We cannot trust our instincts. We cannot listen to our guts. We have to be guided by science, and we have to make decisions on that basis about responding to what is really an existential threat in many parts of the planet. Maybe not for New Zealand as an existential threat, but we will face. We don't live in the world in isolation, and we especially when it comes to climate change. So that action is going, you know, reducing our emissions. I'm really now is the moment. Now is the chance. If we want to stay below 2 degrees, this is where we have to embrace kind of some of the things that the Climate Commission are recommending and actually reduce emissions, not just rely on planting trees. That helps. But we have to start cutting emissions, and we have to find ways to do that. And that's going to be hard, and it's painful, and I'm glad we're having really tough conversations about it.
You have considered carefully what our path is leading us to at the moment. Can you describe what New Zealand might be like in 20 or 30 years, or the weather events that New Zealand might experience in that time if we are in 2021 experiencing the kind of floods we're experiencing at the moment?
Well, that's a great question. I think we'll be experiencing much more severe floods. The sea's going to rise. Let's say 20 years, we're looking at, say, 15 centimetres, regardless of what we do. Could be more with Antarctica melting. That raises the sea level. It raises the storm surge. If Buller had happened in 20 years at a high tide, I don't suppose Westport would have been a very happy place. You know, we got away. We escaped relatively lightly because of the timing of the tides. But let's not think this is a problem for the Westport. It's a problem for anywhere in New Zealand. We live on the coast. and those floods are going to get more severe. We're probably heading towards 2 degrees, right? Like at the moment, in 20 years' time, we might be hitting 2 degrees.
Yeah.
Hopefully policies are starting to come into action and CO2 is starting to be, you know, with that transformation's well underway. But the changes, you know, 2 degrees above pre-industrial is quite a significant. That's where we start to see some big effects on ecosystems. I think New Zealand's iconic ecosystems will be starting to struggle to survive and move and fast enough. So those things we value, the plants and the animals. So then temperatures, of course, heat waves. You know, you might be thinking, well, actually, I'm starting to use my heat pump for air conditioning rather than warming my house in the winter. And there won't be much snow for that skiing unless we, you know, maybe we'll be able to make a bit of snow at some of those higher elevation places. But it's a very different place. Yeah, no, it'll be a challenging for all of us.
Sam, one of the things that struck me from the story we played before is that no longer is it just developing countries that have poor infrastructure that are being smashed by major weather events. I mean, you saw the flooding in the subway in China, for example, the incredible floods in Germany and Belgium. When we look at those kind of extreme weather events, are there any events of that nature that have absolutely no influence from climate change?
So that's a good question. I think all of those events have been influenced by climate change. That so many events are happening around the world at once is probably a pretty good indicator of climate change. It's got the fingerprint of climate change on it, if you will. Some things become less likely because of climate change, severe right. snowstorms or something. But we're not talking about any of those at the moment. So not all hazards get worse, but the flooding, the heat waves, some of these these temperatures in Canada and the US were scary. And I know people living there, and they were scared. They're terrified by, you know, how do you survive in 47 degree temperature without air conditioning, right? Like that's really tough, and it kills people. And that is the path we are taking at the moment.
I noted a piece in Newsroom by Mark Dalda this week that considered some of the news coverage of the floods here in New Zealand, and a large percentage of the news coverage didn't mention climate change. Do you think we in the media need to do a better job of linking extreme weather events to climate change?
I know the BBC, I was reading the BBC this morning, and they certainly put a comment about climate change in every single article. And that's possibly helpful. I sort of personally find that gets a little bit detaching, right? Because you're just seeing the same sentence over and over again, you stop reading it. So I think having comments like sort of stories like this, and I think I've been done quite a lot of I've seen quite a lot of people in the media talking about these events in the last few weeks. I think that's good, and I'm the media's doing okay, really, in sort of promoting or discussing, supporting the dialogue of climate change. I think it's important to keep telling the story of some of these hard decisions about things like electric cars, why we need to do that, right? It would be good to see that discussion alongside those policy decisions, those policy conversations. We shouldn't have them in isolation. They go together, and we have to be reminded of why we're making some of these tough decisions and why we need to do them. And that's the story maybe we're not quite getting to.
This has been a really interesting conversation, Sam. Dr. Sam Dean, tēnā koe, thank you very much for your time.